Subscribers have been wanting me to do a tutorial on how to do this sort of clay work, how to change the shape of a panel. This is a perfect opportunity. We're going to change the shape of this roof just slightly, give it a bit of a more exotic look. So we're going to show you how to do the clay work, and we're going to show you how to make a panel from the clay that you've done, the clay model that you've done. And then we're going to stick it down onto this roof. Now the actual roof itself will not be changed at all. The structure of it will not be changed. It will remain exactly the same. Basically it will be a new panel that will stick down on top of this to change its shape. Basically a body kit for your roof. After the panel has been stuck down and bolted and has been sanded back and primed, then we will show you how to lay carbon fibre over your roof. We will show you how to do all the prep work for that, how to lay it down, then how to finish it ready for a clear coat. As you just saw from the time lapse, we put in our centre line first. This is very important because the centre line, from the centre line, you will measure out both sides and get everything symmetrical and even. Very important to have that. We've got these other two lines here. Fill this in with clay to get our shape here. This here will remain the same. Eventually, that will be carbon fibre with tri-weave to make that look. What we've done here is we've added a bit of cardboard, and that's 12mm thick here, and it tapers down on the back and tapers down on the front, and this will allow us to build the clay up only to a certain level. This will be our guideline. We've cut two exactly the same and stuck them on with tape, and so we'll build this up with clay to that point there. We've got a second line right here, and we're going to taper the clay down to that line, so you have a nice tapered edge there. And this is the clay. Now the clay is potter's clay. We have a scraper, which is a piece of steel which is 2mm thick, and then we have another scraper which is about 15 centimeters long, and it's about 0.5mm thick. And this one's important for getting detail. This here is really, really good for just scraping back hard clay. Also, you'll need a bottle, a spray bottle, and that is to keep your clay moist at all times. So now we'll show you how to lay this clay in a time lapse. Now we've just roughly filled in this area with clay. We take a scraping tool and just scrape it all back. Scrape this down to cardboard line, and scrape this down to the original roof. And you just keep doing that until you get it perfect. Now we actually want a bit of a curve in this. I'll show you how we nice curve across to here. So we take a bit of cardboard, we cut the curve that we want, and then match up the clay to the curve all the way through. See a bit of a gap down there because some clay needs to be filled in. It's here, clay needs to be taken out of the middle in order to match this curve. That's how we get the curve. Perfect there. Now we're creating a nice edge for this. Nice finishing edge. That's what that other line was for. So we just take the clay. Use our scraping tool to get it right. We'll give it a nice finish. Keeps the wet clay away from our fiberglass materials. Tin foil sticks very, very well because the clay is wet. You don't need to worry about the wrinkles because it's not going to be a problem. Wrinkles will come out on the inside of the panel and not the outside of it. So we've got just done the tin foil over the top of the wet clay. Now if this was Y2 clay, you would simply have made a mould straight off it. You wouldn't have had to have done this, and then you would have made copies, and it is much faster doing it that way. But Y2 clay is very, very expensive, and all those other types of clays that car companies use. For example, it would have cost about $3,000 US dollars worth of clay just to do this job. And that's just far too expensive for the average person. So I've had to be innovative and use potter's clay and then cover it with a sheet of this. And now what we will do is we'll cover it with packaging tape, and what that does is it stops the fiberglass from sticking to the tin foil because the tin foil loves fiberglass. Put some resin on top of this and then let it go tacky. Now the resin resin I use is polyester fiberglass resin, and this particular one is blue in colour, and then it goes white as it goes off. Now that this has gone tacky, we want to put this fiberglass cloth on, which is, this fiberglass cloth is 6OZ fiberglass cloth, and it's excellent for making it a way around shapes. This shape is not very complicated, so it's not a big deal, but on more complicated shapes, this stuff is wraps really, really well around them. And we're going to put two layers on. Then we are going to build a bit of a bridge across two areas, and those are just temporary, and they will keep these two pieces square. Now we will wet this out with the same fiberglass resin. Bridges here are only temporary, they're only to keep the two pieces square together when I take it off and when I put it back on. And once it's attached permanently, these bits here will be cut away. Now we leave this for about 16 to 20 hours, then we'll peel it off there and take the clay away. Is that we can line it back up on the car properly. So we've drawn a line down here on the fiberglass, and same here where that centre line is. And now we draw a line on the car up onto our new panel. And we've done the same here and on the other side. And we're doing the same on this side too. That just helps us line everything back up exactly how it's meant to go. We'll be right back. with is a very thin and flexible panel, which will have to be strengthened by adding extra layers on the backside, which we'll show you later. After attaching this panel back on, after cleaning it all up, you can see it's very flexible. It still needs layers put on the other side of it. I really like this shape in here, and these lines here, they work really well with the vehicle. This line here works really well with the similar design on the rear quarters, so that's really good. I have noticed, now that I've had a chance to stand back and have a look at it, that this here area here is too bulbous or too rounded, and so what I'm going to do now, and this is the perfect time to do it, but it's still a rough panel, I'm going to square it off on these two lines, line on each side. Just going to square it off with the clay there and across there. Now if you do decide to change your mind on your design, you can quite simply put this clay straight onto the panel. Like so. And then you can fiberglass, then you can put the tin foil over it, and then you can fiberglass from here straight across. And then you take it off and you cut this old piece of the design out from the back, and then take the clay out. See, we've got a bit more of a square edge there, so it isn't quite so rounded as it was before. And that matches the very square looking door panels. So it looks much better. Sleep, come back, have a look at it. If you're not sure about it within the first 30 seconds, then it's probably not a good design. You either need to change it or you'll need to redesign it altogether. So I'm very happy with this. Our next stage will be to take this back off, and we'll back it with carbon fibre to make it light and strong. And then we'll also make some attachment points where it will screw in into the roof or rather bolt into the roof, and then we'll glass the entire thing on here, and then we'll put our carbon fibre tri-weave strip up the middle. We're not yet ready to attach this panel, but we do want to start doing the preparation for the attachments. When we finally attach this, it will be glassed all the way through, but we still want to be able to bolt it down in several areas, so we have now drilled four 22mm holes, and we've cut out this fiberglass mat, which is 6x6 or 60x60. So here's one of our holes. It's about 10mm deep or 12mm deep. And what we do is we cut out these squares, we place them on the bottom side, we layer them one by one until they reach the top here, and then they glue themselves onto the back. When I put this panel back down on top of them, and then they have an exact shape of the roof, as well as the back of this panel, and they become a perfect fit. Once that has gone off, we then carry on drilling our 22mm hole down 5mm. Then we put on a different drill piece, which is a 6mm drill piece. We drill down, then we place a bolt down through there. So the end result is that the bolt ends up 5mm below the surface. Then we can cap that with a bit of fiberglass, and then Mutec fold over the top. So here we have our attachment points firmly attached to the underside of this panel. So we've now re-drilled these holes here at 19mm, and we've put a hole right way through. They'll fit one of these in. Now these are great because they can be ground off once they're in there, and they've been in the bolt, the nut end's been done up. You can then grind this down to the minimum, which is great when you want to cap this. So if there was a hole through the roof, which there isn't yet, but that falls through like so, you can see how it's below the surface. And once that's bolted up, we grind that down a little bit, then we can cap this with two or three layers of fiberglass, so that there'll be no chance of any imprint of this on the finished paintwork. So all four of them have been done. One other thing you just have to be careful of when drilling holes in your roof is you don't want to be hitting your head on anything. So I've drawn on here where the beams are on the inside, on there. Another beam runs through here. So it's just in behind that beam. This will only stick out at the other end about that much once it's cut down to size. And so 5mm or less than 5mm. And this beam sticks down by 2cm, so there's no way you can hit your head on that because it's so close to the beam. And this is what the attachment points look like on the underside, just like that. It's about 12mm thick, those are. What we've done now is we've taped it down so that it can't move. And we've also marked along here where that door jamb is. We've put a couple of extra marks down there because we're going to actually cut this off before we stick this down, and then that piece will go on separately onto the door, onto the rear door. So now we're just going to drill these holes. So now we've drilled our holes, and we can put our bolt all the way through, like that. This one as well. And because we've now drilled our holes and we know exactly how these sit on the roof, we're able to cut this off. And and get rid of that. That's no longer needed. And we've also cut these sections here off as well. These sections will eventually go onto the back door. So they come off and they'll be attached later on. In addition to drilling the holes for the bolt, we drilled a third hole, which is here. And the reason for that is for hot air to escape, because there is going to be a layer of air between this and the original roof, and that air, when it heats up, needs to be able to go somewhere. Now what we're left with is a very rough panel that needs to be sanded up to look perfect. You can see all the bumps and everything in it. Now, being polyester, as the resin sets, the wax, it's got wax in it, and it rises to the top, and it makes it go very smooth like this, smooth and shiny. Now, that wax layer has to come off, so I used the grinder on it and ground it all back. Now it's ready to accept anything else I put on there, either more polyester, or in this case it's going to be Nutec, which is a 50-50 mix of carbon fibre and aluminium. So the next thing we'll do is we will attach this permanently. We want to prep this roof, prep the paint to accept some fibreglass. What we're going to do is lay the entire surface with a layer of fibreglass, and then before that sets, we'll lay this with some carbon fibre, and before that sets, before the two sets, they will join together and be bolted down like that. So right now we are going to prep the roof, and we use a bit of 80 grit sandpaper, and we just want to rough the surface up, rough it up completely all around, make sure there's no clear coat left. We don't want to go right down to the metal, we just want to rough it up enough to accept some polyester fiberglass mat. Now that we've sanded this, we want to clean it, get all the dust off it. For that, I use some mats. So we've now cleaned this, degreased it, and we cut out a piece of fiberglass mat, the exact shape of the roof. We will then fiberglass this down onto the roof using an unwaxed polyester fiberglass resin. The reason why we use an unwaxed one is because we want to use epoxy on this up the middle when we put our carbon fibre down. So we'll wet this out, we'll bring the other two pieces, bolt them in. They will also be wet when they're bolted down, and that way we get a good mechanical bond rather than just a chemical bond. In other words, this whole thing, including these two pieces that go on here, will be one piece. To add strengthening layers to the underside of the new panels. In this case we're going to use carbon fibre, and the resin we're going to use is a polyester unwaxed resin. which is a 50-50 mix of carbon fibre and aluminium. An excellent bog. It's not like the old bogs, which were basically talcum powder. That's why they were so easy to sand. This is not an easily sandable bog, but it's worth persevering with because it'll outlast even the fiberglass that it's going onto. So by putting your bog on now while it's still tacky, you get a mechanical bond with it instead of just a chemical one, which makes it really, really strong. So this is the stuff. It's called NewTek. It says NewTek Space Age Repairer, good as liquid steel. Excellent product. Shape them up a bit better, so I just let it sit, and I've since ground them up and I'm happy with them. And there's a few things you need to know when putting NewTek or any other bog onto a bare fiberglass surface. The first thing you need to do is blow out all the pinholes, use compressed air, blow them all out. In those stubborn areas, use a stainless steel wire brush and just go over the area, make sure all the dust is out of the fiberglass surface, and then use your air pressure, your blower, get them all off. And also, whenever you touch your work, your sweaty hands have oils in them, and it's important for you to degrease this. So again, I use meths. Meth is good because it cleans the surface and then evaporates once it's been wiped down. Symmetrical when we sand it, so this curve and the curve on the other side has to be symmetrical. There's a curve here which is different from that one, and this has to be symmetrical with the other side. Also, we have to get this here symmetrical, this line, the same on the other side, and we have to blend this down into the back pillar and down into the front pillar to make it look natural. Now, this part of the job can be very, very difficult if you're three-dimensionally challenged. You'll have a job trying to get this perfect. Even these lines here have to be symmetrical and perfect, and there's a lot of defining work to do when you're sanding. And so my advice is to just persevere, keep doing it. If you make a mistake, put more bog on there, do it again until you get it right. It's the only way to learn. Now, as with all bogs, the surface of this, when it goes hard, is quite tacky. That's because the chemicals as they're releasing from it, they react with the atmosphere and make it tacky. That makes it hard to sand. So the best thing you can do is take a scraper, which is just a normal paint scraper, and scrape it all. Sticky layer off. And now you'll be able to sand it without it clogging up your sandpaper. So like I say, this part is very difficult. It can take a lot of practice to get it right. And this is the most hardest part of the job. It used to be the job when I first started doing this 10 years ago. It was the part of the job that I hated the most, but now it's the exact opposite. It's the part I love the most in the whole process. And I'm raring to get into it. Ready to start sanding, and some of the tools I use is a sanding block like that. I also grab a thin steel ruler and I wrap some sandpaper around it. That's excellent to use for getting things like that nice and flat. This here is the old cork sanding block, is very good to use. Also have another little steel ruler, which is good for getting into the little finer places and getting things flat. And I've got various sizes of sandpaper which have just been folded into different sizes. And on the new tech, the best size to use, best grit to use is 80 grit. And then once we go over it with the 80 grit and all the good definition stuff has been done, then we move to a 150 grit before the primer filler. Also, I do occasionally use something like this, a chisel, to really get definition into in a corner area like along here. So now we're going to sand this all back and give it all the high definition lines. In doing this sort of job, never use a dust mask. They're absolutely useless. In fact, you'll put your health in danger. Could even kill yourself. You need a good mask like this 3M mask. It's got double cartridges which are replaceable, and it gets rid of all the dust and fumes. And because this NewTek bog has got a high concentration of aluminium in it, you can get aluminium poisoning if you're not careful, so you don't want to be breathing this dust in at all. Side, and I've got it just how I want it. The next step is to get it exactly the same on that other side. And because this is just a very simple and easy shape, then we're just going to use the cardboard method with the right curve. So each of these lines are numbered, and each one of these lines will have this cardboard cut out, which will curve the exact shape of the roof in that area. And so there's a whole bunch of them here, and then we put these exact same lines in the exact same place on the other side, and then we match these bits of curved cardboard to the other side in the exact the same place. So a very simple way of getting it symmetrical. If it was more of a complex shape like how I did the rear bumper, then I use a technique that I call ribbing. definition lines, and everything's symmetrical. I'm very happy with it. You remember earlier we cut this bit here off the back, and that's supposed to go on there like so. Well, what we're actually going to do is we're not going to use that because there's it's going to be difficult to attach it. So basically we're just going to build a new one right on here with layers of fiberglass, and that'll get rid of any issues of trying to attach this to such a small area. So that's what we're going to do now. As a separate video too, because a lot of people are going to be interested in how to carbon fibre your roof with real carbon fibre. Like I said, we're only going to do this middle piece, but all the processes and steps that we use to lay down the carbon on this, you could use it to lay it over the entire roof. Okay, so these are your materials. You've got the carbon fibre here, you've got the epoxy resins, you've got the hardener, and the resin itself. You're also going to need an epoxy pigment paste. Black, it has to be black. We'll explain that later. You're going to need a couple of brushes, and you need your mess, and you're going to need some masking tape. You're going to need different grits of sandpaper. You're going to need a 120 grit, you're going to need a 400 grit, you're going to need an 800 grit, and you're going to need a 1200 grit. You're also going to need a hairdryer, and if you're going to clear coat it yourself, then you're going to need a lacquer and a spray can, or you can polish it up with an even finer sandpaper. In my case, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to finish it with 1200, and then I'm going to send it to the paint shop, and the painter, when he paints the entire car, will clear coat this to finish it off. Okay, so first thing you need to do is you need to make sure your roof is prepped properly. In your case, you've probably got a paint roof. Your roof has probably got paint on it, so you need to take the clear coat off. Use 100 grit sandpaper to do that. And then follow that up with a 180, then give it a good clean with the meths. Make sure it's completely clean, and then you'll be ready to lay your carbon fibre. Now this roof has been designed using the clay, and then we made a mould and a new panel, and we stuck it on here. That's in the other tutorial. Another thing you're going to need to do is you're going to have to get this rubber out of your way, because you want to get that carbon fibre all the way down in that gap. So this windscreen rubber has to come off or over. There's two ways you can do this. You can take out the windscreen, which eventually I will be doing when it's painted, but for now I've just taped it back so that I can actually get the carbon fibre down in there. Done that for the front also. In this case, because I'm going from the roof onto the back door, I'm going to have to separate this back door and put it down further so that I can get carbon fibre down, right down into this crack, and also wrap it around the boot lid. Now there are a few things you need to know. Epoxies are very good at bonding to polyesters. In fact, an epoxy resin will stick better to a polyester resin than polyester will stick to itself. But you have to know how to prep the surface first. Now, most polyesters have wax in them, so you need to sand all of that wax layer off and then degrease it thoroughly. Now, in this case, we've got NewTek bulk here, so it's not a big problem. There are a few places where the fiberglass has come through, but you'll remember earlier we used a non-waxed polyester for this area here when we attached this roof. In the case of those ones that are just going to sand back their roof, you've got no problems. Your epoxy will stick to your painted roof. So long as it's been sanded back properly and clean, it'll stick really well. Now it's time to mix up the epoxy resin. It's a 2-to-1 ratio. So we've got a set of scales here. We've just weighed out 200 grams. Now we're about to put in 100 grams of the hardener. We put a black pigment through this because this is our base coat. We're going to lay a base coat on here first. It has to be black so that no white or any other colour can show through our carbon fibre. So we're just going to add enough to make sure it goes black. The normal procedure is to let it go tacky, which is the stage it is now, and then you can lay your carbon like what we've done here. We've laid it, but for those at home, we're going to do it differently here because the chances of laying your carbon down on a tacky surface like this and getting it right the first time, if you lack experience, is quite slim. For instance, if you lay this down and you realise some of your lines are wrong, you can't just move it, you've actually got to lift the carbon back off the tacky surface and try and get it right. But every time you lift it off the surface like that, you disturb the weave in the carbon, which makes it useless, so you'd have to rip the whole thing off, grab a brand new piece of carbon and try again. Each time you lift it off the surface, you pit the surface, which can create problems later on when you're trying to smooth things out. So, although we've done it this way here, we are going to do it differently here. We're going to show you a different way. It's more work and more time consuming, but it'll increase the novice's chance of getting it right first time by about 95%. So that's what we're going to do now. We're going to let this harden for the next 24 hours, and then we're going to sand it back with 120 grit. Sanding this with 120 grit. Epoxy is best wet sanded. We've also added a bit of epoxy with the black pigment down here and also down here. It helps to have a tacky surface when you lay the carbon fibre over an edge like this so that it will stay in place and won't pop back up. And so now we're going to cover this area with clear epoxy once these have gone tacky. And then we'll lay our carbon fibre. And doing it that way, we can, because the epoxy here hasn't gone off yet, and it's still viscous, we can actually, if one of these lines are out of place, we can actually manipulate the carbon fibre material to get it all straight again. So here we are 3 hours later and it has gone tacky. And we've taped one end of our carbon fibre to a roll to make sure it stays straight. And we've taped the other end to the windscreen, and that'll help us keep the weave completely straight as we roll it out. I'm actually going to get someone to help me take the other end so and we can roll it. Absolutely perfect, all my lines are absolutely perfect, and probably about 90% of the air is gone out of this now, and so we'll let it set for 24 hours and then we will sand it just a little bit with 120 grit, but it won't be a wet sand, it has to be a dry sand at this stage because you can sand through to the carbon and you don't want to get that wet.
We'll be right back.
So here we are 10 hours later after putting the three coats on. Now it's not completely set, but it's touch dry of course, and it has gone hard, but it could do with another 10 hours before we start wet sanding it and going through the different grits. So since we've got to wait, we might as well start prepping these areas here for primer filler. So we'll use a 180 grit on here, and then we'll clean it with the meths, and then after that we'll put the primer filler on. So now we've sanded this with 180, and we've cleaned it with the meths, but before we cleaned it with the meths, we went over it all with the air gun and got all the dust out of all the pinholes, which are always all the way through your work. Then I treated the little rub throughs where it rubbed through to the steel. That's quite important. I use a black zinc rust protection, which is a rust converter, and I simply spray a bit into the lid and then use a little brush like this to stroke it on. That's good because it prevents you from having to mask up the area. You can just dab it on because it's only little areas. And then the next stage is to put the primer filler on, and I use a 2K 4-1, very good primer filler that can be wet sanded. And this is the hardener or catalyst, and like I said before, you get pinholes through your work. The normal procedure is to buy a special pinholing bog, and then you cover all of this with it and sand it all back. It's expensive stuff, it's more work, but I do things a bit differently, and which actually turns out to be a better job too. Instead of doing that, I simply thin this primer filler down. I put it on, and I don't use a spray gun, because a spray gun, what that will do is it will just cap the top of all of those holes and it won't actually go into it, and then you end up air trapped there. You don't want that. So I use a paintbrush and I just stroke it all in, and it all fills all those pinholes really, really nicely, and it's a better job because that's a high quality product, whereas the expensive pinholing bog is a very soft bog and you can get problems with it later on. So this is a much better way of doing it. Like I said, it's unconventional, but it works and it's a better job. Now it's really important to really work it in there and using the paintbrush. And you'll see little air bubbles and you'll see them slowly get filled. You're going to need three coats, three of these thin coats, with about 20 minutes in between the coats. And then leave for half an hour and then put three thick coats on. That'll give you plenty to sand with. Sand it down with 400 and then you'll sand it down with 800. But you really got to work it into those holes. This is quite nice. It's got a good surface to it. It's not like the normal brush stroke sort of surface. We used a fine brush when we did this, and it's turned out quite nice. It still needs sanding with 400 and then sanding with 800, but for now we're going to turn our attention to this, and we'll start with our 120 and move our way up to 1200. grit. Next we'll sand it with 400, 800 and 1200. And we're going to stop at 1200 with this project because we're going to get our spray painter to spray it with a two-pot clear. But when we get to 1200 I'll tell you your three different options. Smoky appearance to it. But watch what happens when you put a bit of water on. Looks beautiful. So the next process that you do will create this effect. So you now have three options up your sleeve. The first option is you can buy a polishing compound and you can polish this to a high gloss. Your second option is to buy a lacquer in a can, a clear lacquer, and spray that on and it will look like a clear coat over the top. And your third option is to take it to a painter who can paint on a two-pot clear coat, which is the same clear coat that goes on the rest of your car. And that's the option that I'm choosing because it's a much more longer lasting job. It'll last about 20 years and we're painting the whole car anyway, so it just makes sense. But I would like to protect this in the meantime. I'd also like to be able to show you what it looks like with the clear coat on. So we're going to mix up a bit of two-pot clear, the same stuff that will be used on the rest of the car. We'll spray that on so that you can have a look at it, and then later on when the car goes to be painted, the paint shop will simply scuff over it with 800 and then the whole car can be cleared along with this area. Today we're going to concentrate on this, these bits. So we want to sand this down with 400 and then later on in the paint shop it will get sanded down with 800. But today we'll sand it with 4. The very first thing we need to do is we need to put what's called a guide coat on. Now a guide coat is simply an automotive paint, which is a 50-50 mix of the paint and thinner. So it's very cheap to produce, and I would suggest going to see your painter and having some mixed up. Like I say, it's cheap. Now the first thing we need to do is spray or brush this on. In this case we're going to brush it on so we don't spray all over the place. We'll let that dry for about half an hour, then we will sand it down with a 400. Now the purpose of the guide coat is that it gets down into all the hollows, and because it's black and this is white you can clearly see where the hollows are when you sand it. You'll see what I mean later on. And it allows you to sand down to the perfect level, everything nice and smooth. So we'll start on that now. Now you don't have to put your guide coat on really thick, just a nice thin layer. It doesn't have to be even or anything, just have to give it a bit of colour so that you can see what's sanding. This shows us the reason for the guide coat. After sanding this, can see these low spots. So to get a perfect finish, you have to keep sanding this until all the black is gone. Once the black's gone, you know everything's on exactly the same level. Very important for you to use a flat block like this or something similar, otherwise it won't work. So you just keep sanding that. Everything, all the black is gone, and just the white gone. So taken care of these sides. They've been sanded and guide coated, and this everything's masked up, and this has been prepped with 1200, and now all we've got to do is put the clear coat on, and we're going to use a high quality 3-to-1 two pot clear coat that I got from my spray painters, and we're going to put that on, and that'll finish it. For me, it'll only be a temporary finish because we'll go over it again with 800 just before painting the entire car. But for you, this would be your finish that we're about to do. Please subscribe, because there are more videos like this to come. There are several other outside panels of this car that will be skinned with carbon fibre, and also we have these wall panels here. One part will be carbon and the other part will be painted, and so it'll be an excellent opportunity for you to ask certain questions about how things are done, so that when I make those videos I can explain them. We'll also be doing quite a few interior parts. The entire dash of this car will be carbon fibred, skin wrapped, and with real carbon, of course, and other interior parts will also be done, parts of the sound system, etc. So please subscribe, ask questions that you would like to be answered.